Hi there, welcome to Gateway Online. My name is Becky Nelson and we are so happy that you've joined us here this morning. If it is your first time joining us, we'd love it if you'd fill out a digital connection card. You can find that in the link at the bottom, or you can download it at gatewaycc.org/card. It's a great way to stay connected, to find out what's happening here at Gateway, to let us know if you have a prayer request for yourself or someone else. Here at Gateway, we exist to love God, love others, and make disciples. And we are still doing that online every Sunday and all week long. So please reach out. Pastor Randy is continuing in the book of James today, but let's first start with some worship.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan the son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nation with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. Jesus, we sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would pay my. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. all that you've done for me, all that you've done for me.
Sing it out.
All the overwhelming of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. Oh, I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, yeah, yeah. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You've been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Sing it out. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. Oh, I could learn it, don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
If you're just joining us, I'm Becky Nelson, and this is Gateway Online. The message is about to start shortly, but before it gets started, we hope that you'll take the link that you find below and share it with a friend. If you'd like, to follow along in the notes today or have the devotions that go along with the sermon this week, you can get those at gatewaycc.org/notes. We're so excited to be able to offer Gateway online. And if you'd like to partner with us, you can do so at gatewaycc.org/give. Don't forget that today at 10 a.m., our little kids service airs on Facebook, and it's really fantastic. So if you have little ones, I would encourage you to check it out. Now, let's check out Pastor Randy's message.
Welcome back to Church at Home. I am so glad that you're joining us. You know what? If you'll just take a second to type in your name, I would love to see that you're joining us in worship today. I'll say hi to you. I try to log in and do the same thing. And, you know, I don't know about you, but as I start thinking about we're still doing this online thing, and, you know, we were going to do church in our parking lot a couple weeks ago, and we couldn't because there was too much smoke. We got a bunch of fires in this area, and oh my gosh, we can't meet inside, we can't meet outside. Thank you, Jesus, that we can meet together online. So a few weeks ago, we started this series called Faith, A Faith That Works When Life Doesn't. And oh my gosh, how long we've been going through this crisis? Too long, right? I mean, that's really the answer. Well, I want to give a shout out to Pastor Rick Warren for a lot of these insights. I mean, this is just some great stuff. Now today, we're going to be looking at a faith that counters my bad habits. Have you ever noticed that one of the things that happens when we're under stress is we start looking for coping strategies, trying to ease our anxiety and, you know, how do we deal with this stress? Now, unfortunately, a lot of the things that we choose in order to cope with that extra stress tends to be not so healthy for us, right? Those coping mechanisms, a lot of times, they can hurt us more than they can help us. Now, the Bible calls them temptations. And Jesus has some ways to help us. And his half-brother James, who wrote the book of James, you know, he wants us to learn to be overcomers of the things that try to defeat us. The things that Satan uses that says, well, try this. This will make you feel good. And it actually winds up hurting you. All right. So a faith that counters my bad habits. So let's look at James chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. James writes, and remember, when you are tempted, don't say, God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone else. Verse 14, temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. Don't be misled, my dear brothers and sisters. Notice, he's saying that to believers. Now, this is important. As a follower of Jesus Christ, as a child of God, you need to know this. You don't have to face temptation alone. You're not by yourself. Even if you're home alone right now in this crisis, you're not alone. The Bible says in 1 John 5:4, for every child of God defeats this evil world, and we achieve this victory through our faith. And you can overcome temptation. How? With God's help. Jesus has promised to never or leave you or forsake you. You have his help. Now, you and I think you know it, and I think I know it. Listen, when it comes to temptation, willpower is not enough. You know, how many of you would say amen to that, right? You've tried that. Willpower is not enough. Now, willpower can work a few times. It can work for the short-term fix, but it usually can't work for the long-term fix. Now, listen, we know we're not going to be sinless while we live here, right? Okay, we're not going to be perfect. But you know what? With God's help, you can live sin free, free from the bondage of sin. God can free you so that you actually sin less often. All right? He can help you live free from the power of sin. Why? Because as you live in the power of the Spirit, you won't be doing what the flesh or what sin wants you to do, okay? So, you know, let's see how God can help us overcome the power of sin in our lives. Notice this. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, it says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us, notice you got to do something here. Let us, that's me, that's you, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that does so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. People are watching. We got this great crowd of witnesses, your family, your friends, maybe people in heaven, the angels. So we got witnesses. You got people that live around you. And listen, the Bible says, remove anything that hinders you. Get anything that tends to trip you up out of your path. By the way, do you know what tripped you up? You should. You shouldn't have to think too hard about that. So our first point here, in fact, is I need to identify my predictable personal coping failure. Now, this is actually an outline that you can download from our app. I need to personally identify my predictable personal coping failure. You know, what do I do when I'm tempted and when I fall to that temptation? What is my personal coping device? See, whatever it is that trips you up, that's probably your default coping mechanism when you deal with stress. So identify it. Name it. It's really hard to overcome what you can't name. And you got to know that Satan is going to tempt you with that very thing. He's going to tempt you to do something that is self-defeating rather than self-building. And you know what I'm talking about, right? For instance, when we get under stress, when you're under stress, when I'm under stress, like right now, going through this COVID, right now in Sonoma County, we got everything that's going on in the world, plus we got smoke, big time. We got fires, all right? People are getting evacuated. So when we're under this, hear that? A little bit of smoke right there. When you, it's not COVID-19, it is smoke. So when you know that you're under stress, what is your coping strategy, right? Now, some of us are going to resort to food. We tend to eat more when we're under stress. Others resort to drinking alcohol. Some of us resort to just sleeping more. Some of you, when you're under stress, you go shopping. Even if you can't get out of your house, you're going to go to Amazon Prime, right? Has anybody here ever spent more money than on things that you don't need just because you're in this crisis and you feel good when you buy something? Some of us, when we're under stress, binge watch Netflix or Amazon Prime or something like that, right? Listen, the list is long. It's almost inexhaustible. We got video, we got gaming, video games, right? People get addicted to stuff like that. Or, you know, you can get addicted to like anything, drugs, gambling, pornography. Tons of people turn to porn when they're under stress. I was addicted to porn when I was in college, you know, and I didn't have that much stress. It is a trap. You can never get enough. That, by the way, that's how addictions work. You try it, you get some kind of buzz, some kind of high, some kind of good feeling, but then after the high, you inevitably crash. And then we all know the song, I can't get no satisfaction, right? It doesn't matter what that addiction is, when it's controlling you. See, that's what addictions do. They control you and they take you places that you would normally not go because you're in bondage. You're eating too much. You're sleeping too much. You're just doing something in excess, right? And so it takes you places where all of a sudden, whatever that buzz was, you have no satisfaction because you know you're in a self-defeating behavior that's causing you damage. All right. So first of all, you have to identify your predictable personal coping failure. Where am I? Where's Randy? Where is he tempted to fail? All right, name it. Number two, you need to know your emotional triggers, okay? What are my emotional triggers? Now, these are things that make you vulnerable to your particular temptation. So here's a key. Listen and think this through with me. See, a key to defeating temptation is this. Don't focus on your bad behavior. Don't focus on your actions or what you're doing, your behavior. Instead, focus on how you are feeling and, especially key, what's causing you to feel that way? What are you thinking that's causing your feelings that propels you to take action on that, right? See, every action is caused by an emotion, and every emotion is caused by a thought. So, if you want to change the way that you act, you need to change the way you feel. And if you want to change the way you feel, you've got to change the way you think. It all starts in your brain. Now listen, Satan knows this. He knows this about you. You know who else knows that? Advertisers, right? They pray. They're not praying for you, P-R-A-Y. They are praying like a predator, P-R-E-Y. They prey on your emotions. They know how to manipulate you. Satan loves to hook your feelings. He's a master manipulator of your moods. By the way, do you know what is the most common foothold Satan uses in your life to get your attention? It's usually something like this. Negative emotions. Negative emotions give Satan a foothold in your life. That's why the Bible says in Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard your heart. Guard your heart, for it affects everything you do. Now, it's talking about your heart like the center of your emotions. You know, when we say, I love you, we don't usually grab our elbow or grab our head. I love you, right? Your emotions, your heart, your passions, it comes down from in here. And so we're talking about your feelings, right? Your emotions, the heart of your emotions. Listen, we are far more vulnerable to temptations when you're in certain emotional states than you are if you're in other emotional states. And sometimes, you know, depending on your emotional state, you're really ready to resist temptation. He's not getting me now. I mean, if you're in a good emotional state, man, you can resist. If you are vulnerable, down you go. Are you with me? For instance, if you're dealing with physical exhaustion, you may really be susceptible to temptation. If you're dealing with discouragement, if you're dealing with sadness, you know, a loss, you lost a friend, a job, maybe you've lost your health, you got no sports to look at right now, we got no gym to go burn some of that, you know, stuff off, maybe you lost your retirement. I mean, hey, when you suffer through these kind of things, what is your default coping strategy? How do I tend to stumble when I'm under the gun like that, when I'm really emotionally vulnerable? So, you're doing a little self-inventory here. What are my emotional triggers? Ask yourself why you tend to stumble. Number three, what are your patterns? What's your pattern, right? Here I go again, right? Oh my gosh, here I go again. Back to the refrigerator. What is it, right? Now, if you can identify your pattern, then you can protect those problems in advance and you can maybe avoid some of those situations. Right? If you know what tempts you, if I know what tempts me, if you know, and you need to know why you're tempted, okay? You got to know the when and the where and all those other details. The Bible says in Proverbs 14:8, the wise man looks ahead. The fool tries to fool himself and he won't face the facts. Got to look ahead, right? You know what a foolish person does when they're tempted? When it comes to temptation, here's what a foolish person does. And I've been this foolish person so many times. Foolish people rationalize. You know what? I deserve this. Have you ever told yourself that? I deserve more ice cream, Haagen-Dazs, right? I deserve that bag of chips. I deserve this, you know, this alcohol. Oh, you know, I'm just so down. I gotta do that. And alcohol's a downer and it brings you more down. You rationalize. I deserve something to buy on that. I deserve this. I just saw it on television. I deserve, right? You give yourself permission. You rationalize. And rationalize, you know, here's what it means. In context to kind of dealing with your temptations in a bad way, rationalization means you tell yourself, or you might even tell others, rational lies. We justify in our mind what we know is wrong in our heart, right? That's what we tend to do. See, mature people are self-aware of their patterns. Here's five questions that you can ask yourself that can help you discover your patterns. Ask yourself, number one, you know, when am I most tempted? Do a self-evaluation. What day of the week? You know, am I more tempted on a Monday or a Friday, right? Or a Saturday or a Sunday? What time of the day am I more tempted? Morning or afternoon or evening? You know, Maybe it's really late at night when everybody else has gone to bed. When am I most tempted? Pastor Rick Warren says this. He said, I can handle any diet until noon. Can you relate to that? Right? The fact is that we are tempted at different times of the day. So, number one, when? Number two, where? Where am I more tempted? You know, am I most tempted at work? Am I more tempted in the kitchen? Am I more tempted at sitting in front of a computer? Am I more tempted in front of the TV? Maybe you're more tempted if you go to the 7-Eleven or a sports bar. Be honest with yourself. Where are you more tempted? Now, listen, my advice is simple when it comes to that. If at all possible, avoid the places that cause you more problems. Now, that's tough to do if it's your home. That's a pretty tough thing. But if at all possible, stay away from those areas that cause you the most grief. If you're allergic to bees, stay away from the bees. Don't go near the beehive, okay? Don't go to a bar to eat pretzels if you have a problem controlling your drinking. So when am I most tempted? When am I most tempted? Where am I most tempted? And here's another one. Who is with me when I'm most tempted? Maybe you're by yourself. I don't know. Maybe you're with a group of friends or coworkers. Who are you most tempted with? Crowds? Alone? Your buddy? Your friend? I don't know. You know, just think that through. Maybe you're most tempted to get angry when you're with your family, okay? That can be convicting, by the way. It certainly is for me. But you need to know, who am I around when I'm most vulnerable, all right? Here's what I'm saying. You got to think through what's causing these things. What are your triggers? Number four, this is a good one to think through, friends. What temporary benefit do I get when I give in to temptation? Boy, that's a good one, right? What temporary benefit do I get when I give in to temptation? See, when I give in to anger, or when I give in to food, when I give in to pornography, when I give in to controlling a situation, when I give in to fear, when I give in to worry, what do I get when I'm giving in to the thing that I fall to temptation and sin with, all right? You have to ask yourself, you know, hey, if you give in to drinking, well, you know, what comfort are you getting out of that, right? Does it give you more excitement? Does it give you relief? Do you just kind of forget about things? You know, does it give you a false confidence? Listen, don't kid yourself. There is a reason why you fall to temptation. Now, I am not throwing condemnation your way, my friends. I'm trying to help you discover some insights about yourself so you can overcome this. Satan is the one that wants to steal, kill, and destroy you. I want to help you. Jesus said, I've come to give you life. So we just got to think this through. Don't kid yourself. There is a reward, or you wouldn't be sinning. You wouldn't fall to that thing. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25, there's pleasure in sin. Listen, if sin wasn't pleasurable, nobody would do it, right? If sin caused you amazingly excruciating pain, would you really be doing that? You know, poking yourself in the eye, you know, hitting your thumb with that? No, you know, there's some kind of pleasure. There's some kind of payoff. Just look at whatever it is that you fall to. What is that payoff? Okay. Number five, how do I feel? Now we're back to feelings again. How do I feel right before I'm tempted? Am I most tempted to be frustrated when I'm scared, or when I'm bored, when I'm angry, when I'm lonely? Am I most tempted when I can't sleep? I just sleep deprivation when you're stressed out? You got to know your emotional triggers. How do I feel right before I fall to those things? All right. So those are five questions that you can do to try to discover, you know, what triggers you. Okay. Now, once you know the answers to 1, 2, 3, and 4, here's a fourth step. And you can, and you know, point number four, plan to avoid the situations that cause you the most grief. Proverbs 4:26 says, plan carefully what you do. Avoid evil and walk straight ahead. Don't go one step off to the right or the left, right? Don't go one step off the right way, all right? So, in other words, if you know your situation, You know your triggers, and you know when you're more tempted to get angry or to exaggerate. You know when you're more tempted to lie or try to control, or you know when you get angry, you know when you're jealous, you know when you might get envious. If you know those negative emotions and situations that set you up for falling to temptation, it's a pretty good idea to avoid those situations. Pretty good idea to avoid those places, right? Here's a practical one for you. If you're trying to diet, don't go and sit to do your homework or do your office work or your calls at an ice cream parlor or your favorite Mexican restaurant, okay? Maybe you should learn to carry healthy snacks with you. Just saying, plan ahead, right? Avoid the situations, plan ahead. If you can do that, it really is going to be bad. Maybe if you have to take a flight, maybe you should avoid certain books or certain stores before you get on your flight, so you're not, you know, looking at the wrong kind of stuff. Maybe you need to block some channels on your TV. Maybe you need, you know, or your internet or on your phone. Listen, whatever it takes, do whatever it takes to avoid the stuff that you tend to fall with. Now, let me just be honest. I'm saying pray, plan, because I want to set you up for victory, okay? But you know and I know that even with your best intentions and your best planning, sometimes, you know, the Bible says Satan's like a lion. Sometimes temptation ambushes you. Am I right? I mean, you can have healthy snacks. You can be planning all this stuff and you can still have an ice cream truck drive to your house, right? I'm just saying, temptation can ambush you. You're going, you're watching on TV, you're not looking for something bad, and then boom, something bad happens right there that you know you shouldn't be looking at, and now you've got to deal with it. You get ambushed. When temptation ambushes you, now you're in a 911 situation. You need emergency tactics to keep you from falling back into your self-defeating behavior. So that's where point number five comes in. Step number five is ask for God's help. Ask God for help. God is willing. He wants to help you, right? He's every step of the way. So when temptation pounces on you, when you get ambushed, you know what you need to do? Pray a microwave prayer. What's that? Not a long prayer. It's not a theologically deep prayer. It's a passionate plea for help. And you know what? You could just pray this. Help! That's it. One word. Maybe you don't even have the words. Ugh. I mean, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit can pray through you with groans that you don't even get. That kind of stuff. Man, the Holy Spirit can even use that. Pray a microwave, passionate call to God for help. He hears it. When Peter was going down under and about to drown when he was after walking on the water, Lord, help, save me. It doesn't have to be a deep prayer to have big time results. I mean, God knows our hearts. I love Psalm 50, verse 15. It says, God, I need help. And it says, call to me when trouble comes and I will save you. Just call out to God. When temptation comes out of nowhere and you've been ambushed, pray help. Just let it flow out of your help. And by the way, do you know why that you can expect God to help you? The Bible says that Jesus understands our weaknesses. Jesus knows. He knows our own personal default negative behavior. He knows the sin that does so trip us up. He knows those bad habits. He knows what we've been addicted to. He knows the areas where we're vulnerable to. He knows yours and he knows mine. In Hebrews chapter 4, it says, talking about Jesus, he understands our weaknesses. Why? For he faced the same temptations we do. Did you know that? Jesus was tempted, literally it says, in all points like we were. Any and every way that Satan has ever tempted you, he tempted Jesus. Satan was trying everything he could think of to get Jesus to fall. Think about that with me. If there was anybody that Satan wanted to try to trip up and get them to sin, it would be Jesus. Satan threw every temptation he's ever thrown at anybody at Jesus. He threw them all at him, probably numerous times. Fact is, Satan manifested himself face to face with Jesus. I don't know if I've ever come face to face with Satan himself and the personification Jesus did. I think little minions, in fact, sometimes they don't even know, I don't even need any help to fall. My own flesh, right? It says, temptation comes from our own desires. The Bible says Jesus was tempted in every point like we are, and yet he did not sin. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. Was Jesus ever tempted to be discouraged? Yes, he was. Was Jesus ever tempted to be prideful? Yes, he was. Was Jesus ever tempted to retaliate? You betcha. Was he ever tempted to get drunk and abuse alcohol? Yes, he was. Think about that. I mean, he could have turned all the water into wine. And no, he was tempted in every point. Exactly. Listen, was Jesus the Holy, the anointed Messiah, the Christ of God, was he ever tempted to sin sexually? Yes, he was. Satan made sure of it. When people were accusing Jesus of all kinds of sin, when they were accusing him that he didn't know his Father, God, don't you think he had a little bit of, I'll show you? I'm telling you, Jesus was tempted in every point, and yet he did not fall. He overcame every one of them. Listen, it is possible he wants you and I to partner with him and overcome all of the sin, all of the temptation that Satan throws at us. Which is why it goes on to say in this verse, so, because Jesus has been successful at overcoming every temptation and any default behavior of humanity, it says, so let us come boldly to our gracious God. And there we will receive his mercy and grace to help us when we need it. Wow. That's just what I was saying. Did Jesus struggle with loneliness? Yes, he did. Fatigue? Yes. Anger? Yes. He was God. He was in a fully divine, in the spirit. No part of God was lacking from him, and yet he was fully human in a human body. So, I gotta say, I love this passage, and there's actually, I got four more points to give you on how we can overcome this stuff. I've run out of time, so I'm gonna do that again. I'm gonna do that. The next four I'm gonna do next week. We're gonna have a little teaching in the midweek for you to kind of supplements this as well. But I just wanna say, go back and listen to this again. And this is great stuff. You know, memorize a few key verses. Learn to pray and resist temptation. With all of my heart, I want to live a life that pleases God. I want to have a life that's full of joy and peace. I want to resist temptation, and I want to help you do the same. God loves you. I love you. God has put love in my heart for each of you, and I can't even see all of you. But I want you to live a life that pleases God and is one that overcomes everything that Satan throws at you. The good news is, if we do fall, and I have and you have, the Bible says, not only can God help you not fall, but when you do fall, he can pick us back up. Let's pray. Would you bow your head and pray with me? Father, we're all tempted on a daily basis. And we have different points of weakness. You know them all. We have different places or different areas, different triggers. You know them all. Lord, I've got places in my life, situations, emotions where I am very vulnerable. Thank you that you know them. And thank you that for every person out there, whatever their point of weakness, whatever their unhealthy coping mechanism is, whatever that temptation is, Lord, you know what it is. And you want to help us all overcome them. Just ask God to help you overcome your area of weakness. Help God, Father, help us all to discover our triggers, discover where we're most vulnerable, when we're most vulnerable, with who we're most vulnerable. Lord, help us to understand these things. And then God, equip us with the sword of the Spirit, with the armor of God. Equip us with the shield of faith. Equip us to overcome the temptations. Lord, we know we're vulnerable. The Bible says, you know, take heed, he who thinks he stands, lest he fall. But that no temptation has overtaken us, but God knows every one of them. And every time we're tempted, you'll make a way of escape. We're going to talk about that more next week. But Father, we pray right now, as we're tempted during this week, help us to make the choice to escape the temptation and not to fall. But you know what? Have you fallen? I know I've fallen. Father, forgive us of those areas where we have fallen. Maybe you just pray that in your heart right now. Father, forgive me. In fact, let's just ask God, forgive us with the blood of Jesus right now. Father, forgive us of our sin. Thank you for your forgiveness. Help us to resist temptation and to use the resources that you have provided so that we can live a life of victory and freedom over temptation and sin. And Father, we ask this in your name, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. What a great message we heard today. The book of James is so real and so relatable. When you read it, it's almost like you're sitting down and having a conversation with a friend. And speaking of something that's relatable and real, take a moment to look around and take a look at all the plants and the trees that are around you throughout the day. The glory of God is all around us. Have you ever thought about how plants reflect the relationship that we have with God? The plants take in the nutrients from the soil through the roots. Those roots anchor the plant into the ground as well. We don't see the roots all of the time, but they are there. Is your soul anchored in Christ? What work is he performing in you at this very moment? People might not see the work that he is performing in you and that he is doing in you just yet, but God is still working on you. Now, as you grow in Christ, think about the stem of the plant. You are growing vertically and continuing to establish the relationship with him. Now, if you keep growing, you'll grow horizontally as well, establishing your branches and or your leaves too. You are establishing a relationship with others and covering one another with God's love. So I'll leave you with this. Grow in Christ and spread his love to others. Now let's take a moment to remember the sacrifice that Christ made on the cross for us, and then we will partake of the communion. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to partake in communion. We ask that you just bless this communion and bless us, God. Help us to be able to just share that love and just to experience that love which you have given to us, God, with others. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. In Corinthians chapter 11, it says, the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do you in remembrance of me. Please partake. And after the same manner, he also took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Please partake. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to just, again, partake of communion and share those elements, God. We ask that you continue to bless our bodies and give us peace through everything that's going on. And just, God, continue just to keep us as we go through our daily lives. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up. and you all climb up coming after me. So why you all kick down, lie you all tear down, coming after me.
Sermon. I'm so glad you were here to join us. If you accepted Jesus today, we really want to know about it. So I hope you'll take the time to fill out that connection card I mentioned earlier at gatewaycc.org/card. One of our pastors would just love to encourage you and send you a Bible. I want to thank you if you're partnering with us through giving. Your giving is making an impact on your community. If you'd like to learn more about partnering with us through giving, you can do so at gatewaycc.org/give. See you next week.